Hi everyone, well in this video I'll be taking a look at Linux Mint 17, the KDE version. Well okay, I pretty much missed the ballpark on reviewing most distros that are based on Ubuntu 14.04, but since their long-term support release, they're around for 5 years, my review will still be relevant for some time yet. And this is the first time I've reviewed a Mint distro that's based on KDE. I've reviewed Mint before, but it tends to be the Cinnamon or Mate versions, and I've reviewed KDE distros before, and in fact I'm using one here, which is Kubuntu. So how does it compare to the other KDE desktop releases that I've looked at in the past? Well, not great, it's near the bottom of the list. Netrunner being at the end, which is more of a glitz and glamoury desktop, kind of has the excuse there of being more bloated. But Mint 17 just seems to be pretty much a standard KDE desktop and doesn't really match in with the rest of their theming that they've done on the Cinnamon and Mate. So what would draw me to this system? Nothing. Simple as that. I can see at first glance some of the features that they've done, and that's installed restricted extras and binds the Windows key to the launcher. That's kind of handy if you're a new user and you wanted that, but really? If you're a new user, I would recommend that you tried Solid K if you're after a KDE desktop. If you wanted more of the glitz and glamoury KDE desktop, then I would recommend you try Netrunner. So realistically, Mint 17 kind of falls in that gap of not really being that suitable on any particular level. The only point it wins at is it can be better on drivers. I've heard a lot of people having better luck with drivers for a more obscure hardware on Linux Mint. So maybe that's its winning point there. Let's take more of a look at the system. Okay, starting with the layout of the desktop. It's pretty simple really. It's just got the application launcher on the left hand side. You've got a show desktop icon. You've got a shortcut to the Dolphin file manager. Then on the system panel we've got the update manager, volume control, network icon, notifications, time and calendar, and the cache to add widgets or lock them all in place. Well, since I've got the update manager open here, I'll take a look at it. It's slightly different than it has been before because it now shows the level 4 and level 5 updates by default. I've just taken it as it is out of the box here, not done anything. Okay, we do have the option now of installing the level 4 or level 5 updates, so which Linux Mint consider that may damage your system. Yeah, it's kind of dubious, sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. But then again, you've got security risks with the kernel, eventually. This is something I've pointed out in another video that I did. So with KDE, we have the option of adding various widgets, and so we'll take a look here what comes pre-installed. It didn't really look anything particularly noticeable of being unique to the system here. These are all what you can get in Kubuntu. Though I can't remember if you get the Lancelot launcher out of the box, but anyway, you've got that, and usage login is activated, okay. So yeah, right. Let's take a look at that. Now that is the launcher I would have thought they would have used, which is kind of closer to the rest of their systems, but there are more Plasma widgets available through the Software Center, either through Synaptic Package Manager or the Software Manager. And that would be Plasma. What do they call them? Plasma widgets. Oh, there you go. Just type in Plasma and you get a few appear. So there you go, a few different Plasma widgets to choose from. Now, one of the more unique features with Linux Mint is the better handling of the drivers, in that they seem to be able to allow more obscure hardware to work in Linux. For example, a wireless network card that won't work in any other distro, then maybe it will work in Mint. They did have the VirtualBox Guest Editions pre-installed on the system, which does bulk things out if you're not using it in VirtualBox. But, okay, well it made it easy for me testing it out here. Can't complain at that, but can complain about the bulk and additional boot-up time it does cause. It's about 3 seconds longer in VirtualBox compared to a Kubuntu. It doesn't sound like much, but that is more than 10% increase on boot-up time. Without much more notable about the system, let's take a look through what they have pre-installed. So on the graphics, we do have the GIMP image editor. Under Internet, we have Firefox for the web browser and Kmail for the email client. Under Multimedia, we have Amarok for the audio player, and Dragon Player and VLC for the media player. And as I mentioned earlier, we do have the restricted extras pre-installed. For Office, it's the partial suite of LibreOffice version 4.2. Under System, we do have one of Mint's own tools here, which is the backup tool. And there should be the domain blocker as well somewhere. Where is that? System settings looks pretty much like a standard Kubuntu system, but we've got Mint Display Manager login settings, because evidently it uses the Mint Display Manager for the login screen. Okay, we'll take a look at that in a moment as well. Now, I was trying to think what this domain blocker was, so in the end I just gave up and typed in domain blocker. And I'm just looking across there and I have a rather large spider crawling up my wall, so I'm going to make this a bit quick and then get rid of that spider before it interrupts my review any further. bbc.co.uk, close that. Go to Firefox. And we'll see we're unable to connect to that page because it's now blocked. So it's a pretty crude, simple way of blocking web pages. Now we'll go and log out and take a look at the Mint Display Manager login screen. Oh, well, it's animated. Doesn't that look quite nice? And we've got auto login. Cool. Here's what I thought of Linux Mint 17, the KDE version. So it comes ready to use out the box, and it comes pre-set up with a launcher bound to the Windows or Superkey. But on the downside there, the update manager is balanced on stability rather than security, but at least it does give you the option now of showing you that the updates are available. It just doesn't select them by default. So you have got the choice of going, should I potentially break my system or should I keep it running? Since the distro could be around for 5 years, yeah, it's kind of a dubious one. You might want to update that kernel at some point because it is going to pose a risk, as I've said in the past on another video. And its final downside there, it's not really much better at first glance than Kubuntu with restricted extras and KSuperKey. I did mention at the beginning that you do have the advantages with it being potentially better for drivers of obscure hardware. You might be better off with Linux Mint. Oh, one obscure bug there that I wished I'd taken a screenshot of. I've missed that chance now. The installer said that on completion my hard drive would be 1 byte large. 1 byte? God, I don't know when computers were last of that size on a hard drive. Probably never. But anyway, overall I have given it 80%, which is only about 2% worse than Kubuntu is. Thanks for watching. I'll see you all later.